Welcome back to SoilWorks Soil Solutions with our world-famous entomologist, Dr. Tom Dykstra.
That's you.
Me.
Yes. Thanks for being here, Thomas.
Sure thing.
We're going to continue the talk about tillage and no tillage.
Okay.
We're not against either as long as it's working.
Correct.
And in a short answer, how would you define working in a system?
High-BRIX plant. If you're dealing with a high-BRIX plant that's healthy, I'm all for it. So whatever system you want to use, if you do till, no-till, strip till, and if you like to stand on your head and chew gum while singing the national anthem backwards, if all of that works for you and you get a high-BRIX plant, then I'm all for it.
Yeah. One of the problems we were working on in the apple industry is bitter pit.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of these newer varieties, in my terminology, being from South Dakota, these newer varieties are high sugar, which means they are calcium and phosphorus sucking pigs.
That is really interesting.
Those are technical terms.
Technical term. Okay.
What I mean by that is, in the apple industry, there was a lot of pressure and there's a lot of conversation. And it said, oh, it's a calcium deficiency. Everything's calcium. So they're spraying calcium nitrate. They're spraying calcium chloride. They're spraying all these different calciums on the leaf. And sometimes they'd see a little response. Many times they would see virtually none.
Mm-hmm.
What you'd seen?
That is true. I know that a few decades ago when calcium nitrate was first discovered as being beneficial, it had a little bit of a beneficial effect. That has now carried through, hasn't been, I think, efficiently tested since then. But the indication is we tested it once, we're always going to apply calcium nitrate. And as Glenn was just mentioning right now, calcium nitrate is not solving the problem.
Yeah. So in different states here in the U.S. where the Honeycrisp and many of the higher sugar, wonderful, higher demand apples were grown, when we threw our hat into the ring saying, oh, I think we can fix that with a pound or two of calcium through the drip line, through the emitter, by the rhizosphere of the plant, I had to wait for everybody to stop laughing. Rightfully so.
Maybe minutes, not seconds. Minutes.
It was minutes.
Yeah.
So they gave me the opportunity, and our first go was horribly unsuccessful.
Well, this is the way you start out.
We knew that there was compaction in the ground, and we put out a pound of our calcium, and we opened up the ground and relaxed the surface tension. We got air in there, but we saw no difference, no decrease in the bitter pit. So it's like,
Tell me, what did you do next?
This is going to hurt me.
Yeah.
To say this.
Say it anyway.
But I had your scratchy voice in my head. It's all about sugar.
Oh.
It's all about bricks.
I love you, man.
It's all about photosynthesis.
Yeah, yeah.
So we started putting 5 pounds, 10 pounds.
Sure.
Some guys went 15 pounds of
sugar.
Sure,
sure.
Some guys did some molasses.
Mm-hmm.
Can you guess what we saw?
You saw some level of improvement as the BRIX began to increase, as long as you effectively fed the microbes, which I think you're doing a pretty good job of doing right now.
Some of the soil had a high pH.
Okay, that's a problem.
And the sugar started stabilizing the hydrogen, pH being potential hydrogen, we started bringing that down. When we got down below 7 pH, all of a sudden some hydrogen started showing back up on the clay colloid, the base saturation, and we started seeing, and we were looking at petioles and tissue tests, and what we found is when we got to about 2% calcium on a petiolar tissue and 0.3% phosphorus, 2% calcium, 0.3 phosphorus, that was kind of the level that we had to be above to get rid of the bitter pit. And when I say get rid of the bitter pit, these guys had 20, 30, 35% showing up of bitter pit. We went in and we dropped it to 0.
Now, when you say zero, what do you mean exactly?
The picking versus the pack out. What they pick and put into the bin and then pack out, there was no incidence of bitter pit upon the pack out.
Even after you picked it off of the tree and it was a self-composed apple, it still wasn't getting bitter pit at that point.
We had better color.
Oh, yeah.
We had more uniform size. We had higher BRIX. Coming back to the sugar daddy, the grand poobah, aloha, Tom. But we increased the sugar content, and what we found is after we got snubbed and got beaten down where we failed, we came back and said, we need carbon, we need oxygen, we need hydrogen, i.e. sugar.
Yeah.
So the sugar, and that's where your scratchy voice is, the sugar fed the microbes broke nutrients down, and we got more sugar into the plant.
The microbes also really are not very comfortable in a high pH system, so they are going to make a lower pH. Therefore, when you have a high pH, you're almost always dealing with a low microbial population. Now, by putting the sugar down, you're actually increasing the microbial population, which allows them to stabilize the pH into something which is more comfortable for them, which is, you know, usually below 7 for almost all cases. Sometimes a little bit lower. We can hit 5, and certainly blueberries are amazingly successful at 4 pH too. But 5 is works for a lot of citrus and some others. So we've got this capability of doing it, and this is all based upon some very simple type of additions, and we're talking about sugar right now. Mm-hmm. And the massive changes that occur, which is now measurable too, because we have a BRIX refractometer to measure it, and we are now starting to solve problems. This makes us look like geniuses. I know you're not. I know I might be. And so because of that, you're going to make a comment right now, or am I just going to keep going with this?
There's a fine line between idiot and genius. And we're both on the same page.
We're walking that tightrope right there.
Because that fine line is success.
Yes.
So everybody thought I was an idiot, and they're probably right, saying a pound or two of our calcium that has been structured, it has been cleaned, it has been separated.
Not your normal calcium.
Not your normal run-of-the-mill calcium.
No.
And it's not a long-term deal.
Yeah.
You don't have to use it forever. It's to stop the problem or to start the healing process. But we wouldn't have done it without your information, without your knowledge and guidance, is feeding the microbes the sugar, the molasses. And I'm talking about simple household white table sugar.
That'll work too. That'll work too.
That you can buy in any big box store.
Yeah, yeah.
Molasses is a wonderful indication. What we're doing is we're putting anywhere from 5 to 10 pounds of sugar on some of the tighter soil.
Yeah.
And we're going 15 to 20 pounds more on the lighter soil that is below,
yes,
100 psi of compaction.
And what you're doing with that molasses is, of course, very sticky, as I'm sure you're all aware. And when you put it on sandy soil, it adds a certain level of stickiness to the soil, meaning that some of the nutrients are less likely to leach through. So the benefits for molasses, or even all types of sugar too, are actually much larger on sandy soil. Maybe less so for others, but just to add to the and to emphasize what Glenn is saying, I have known individuals who put 30 to 40 pounds of sugar on it. Now, this is something that, you know, if you know that you're dealing with a low BRIX plant and that you're not getting enough sugar being pushed into the soil, you can go that high. You simply have to dilute it. Make sure you do that, otherwise the spigots can all get clogged up. But as long as you dilute it enough, you can put 30 to 40. There's a lot of flexibility when it comes to sugar. There's not that precision that many of you are familiar with when you're putting on a pesticide. You can't go above this level, you can't go below that level, and it's all very, very tight. And the same thing occurs with many of the NPK fertilizers too. It's a very tight amount that you're supposed to be putting on. Not so with some of the nutritionals that we were talking about, including sugar, where the range that you can put on is much, much larger. And that's really part of the beauty of the system, is that you don't have to think as much. Because both of us don't like to think that much.
Well, with thinking, we had a vegetable grower that had a little bit too high a pH, 7.2, 7.3.
Yeah.
And when we were talking to them, we had mentioned 5 to 10 pounds, maybe 15 to 20. They went 50.
Oh, they did go to 50.
5-0.
As long as you have enough water, you can dilute it.
Well,
all right.
I didn't find out about this until after they did it.
Oh, they did that on purpose.
Yes.
Yes.
And they said, what do you suppose would happen? And this is in the fall of the year after what the season.
What a setup.
Yeah. I love these guys. They said, what do you suppose would happen if we would over-apply this sugar? It's like, oh, I said, define over-apply. Oh, you were talking 5, 10, 15 pounds. What if we put down 50? I said, well, your pH is going to come down. He goes, what else? It's like, I don't know. I said, I don't think anything harmful, but that's an area. It's
generally not. We haven't had really any harmful effects.
No familiarity, but I said, yeah. I can't believe that what he says. So you'd be okay if we did that? I said, well, now you're going one step further. Yeah. But sometimes a mistake or an over-exaggeration is many times the, aha.
Yeah. And that's especially aha, because when you're dealing with low BRIX plants, such as 3 to 5 BRIX, BRX, meaning B-R-I-X, so then you've got plants that are not putting enough sugar into the soil. And at that point, I can suggest and have suggested that they put on much more sugar than is usually comfortable for some people to do so. Because yes, you do hear about sometimes as little as 1 pound, and sometimes people get crazy and go up to 20. But believe me, you can get far more crazy than 20 pounds per acre. So it's really not as much as you think it is. For example, a molasses, a gallon of it weighs 12 pounds. So you're only dealing with a few gallons of molasses over an acre. So as long as you put sufficient water down, you shouldn't have any trouble putting it down. So it's not as if you're applying pure gooey syrup all over your acreage. I don't want people to get that idea.
Man. The one thing, if I can add, please pay attention to the source of molasses that you get. Molasses naturally has iron occurring in it. If you have high iron in your soil and you overdose the molasses, excess iron is going to tie up phosphorus.
Therefore, if molasses is a potential problem and you wanted to put crazy amounts of like 50 pounds of sugar down, can you mix molasses and sugar in order to get to your 50 pounds? Or do you just prefer to use one?
Why do some people ask questions they already know the answer to?
Because this is called a setup.
Oh!
That's what it is.
Yes. In fact, our calcium, the soft rock phosphate that's in micronized, thank you for that question.
You're welcome.
But our calcium, the soft rock phosphate, sugar and molasses are all extremely compatible, mm-hmm, because it's the healing dose of calcium that I consider the mother of all minerals, and then the food source for the microbes with the sugar and the molasses, plus there's some trace minerals. Just be careful with the molasses and watch your iron levels, because that can cause a problem. With the bitter pit, watching these numbers, would you and can you define any other diseases that haven't been stopped by raising the sugar content of a plant? Not saying they're not out there, but do you know of any diseases, any problems, any fungals, any bacteria, any viruses that can't be naturally controlled by the plant if it's healthy?
I don't know of any diseases at all that cannot be completely and utterly controlled by having a high BRIX plant, which is going to be in the double digits. So no, I've not run across any in nature. I've not run across any in a crop situation, in a farming situation. It is about as absolute as you can believe. And for anyone who thinks that this may be a bit extravagant, please remember that what that thing is measuring is a lot of different parameters. This is not just about a magic pill that you place on something and everything just is wonderful and a beanstalk goes up into the sky, yada, 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 we know the story. The fact is, when you are measuring with the BRIX refractometer, you're measuring a whole host of biochemical incidents that have happened in order to get to that point. So you're measuring a lot with that. So please don't think that this is just a rather simple thing, that it's necessarily a magic bullet. We use this, the BRIX refractometer, because we want to see how we're doing in the most general of senses. And because it's dirt cheap, because we can get them for less than $100 online, and the cost that it takes for you to use them is just your time. And so the beauty of that system we are now talking about right now, for those of you who are not familiar with it, I just wanted to make that quick mention to you, as well as some of the other instrumentation that are used in order to help farmers to bypass some of the diseases, all of them unnecessary, without exception.
I don't know what you heard, but I just heard a challenge. If anybody has a disease that you're calling hooey,
I'm just going to move here for effect.
Okay. Please let us know. Tell us what your BRIX are. Tell us what your air in the soil is. Tell us what the EC is. And let us see if we can fix it. Because we're with Dr. Soil Works. We correct the cause rather than reacting to the symptoms. We have a wonderful guide here, the sugar daddy of plants. If they'd like some more information on BRIX and EC and some of the other crazy stuff that you're doing.
Yeah, some of that crazy stuff is on YouTube right now. Okay. So if you do a search for Thomas Dykstra, you'll run across some of that crazy stuff on YouTube.
Well, for Dr. Dykstra and me at Soil Works, thank you for watching and look forward to the next opportunity.